Okay, shall we start? Welcome, everybody. My name is Aleksander Zdyb. I come from Poland, but currently I'm based in Switzerland. I'm going to tell you about modern security model for Linux operating systems. Why you might be interested in this? This particular model is meant for embedded systems like smartphones, smartwatches, smart TVs, and so on. And it's probably unlikely that you will have to design such kind of system in nearest future, because there are already many of them, like Android, iOS, Windows, Tizen, even if you haven't heard of it before. But if you were yesterday on John Hawley's presentation about IoT devices, there's gonna be a hell lot of them, these IoT devices. And each of them is gonna to run on some system, probably a dedicated one, but maybe not. And they will really need some security. Till the year 2020, there's gonna be 10 million of us developers focused strictly on IoT devices. So there will be a lot of work on these devices, and these devices will need to be secure. And I'm going to present a choice for security framework you can use on these devices if you happen to design on or develop a system for such devices. Well, what I'm going to tell you about. First of all, about security considerations, security requirements of embedded devices. How are these requirements different from, for example, desktop computers or servers? Why is it important? Next, what is the mission to accomplish in order to have this security in place and working? Next, we're gonna focus on some technical details, implementations, and so on. At the end, we have some short summary, and if time allows, a short Q&A sessions. So, what about these security requirements, or why we need security on embedded devices? There are a lot of IoT and other embedded devices right now. And the pictures above are just pretty usual right now. We use more and more of embedded devices, and we store more and more private data on them. And these ones, like smartphones, smartwatches, tablets, TVs, are probably known to store such kind of data. But there are more. Yesterday, you could see that there are thermostats, thermometers, even pregnancy tests with connectivity, yeah, like John yesterday showed. And sometimes we are not even aware that these devices are surrounding us and that they gather and store and share information about us, about our environment. However, there is some data on them, flying between them, and it needs to be secure. So, maybe some simple example. You can see two similar pictures, one taken on Ubuntu, the second taken on Android. This is screen showing installation of software on corresponding devices. What's the difference? I mean, both have name of the application, some descriptions, some nice screenshots, but what's the difference between desktop computer like Ubuntu and embedded mobile device like Android in this case. Well, when you try to install the application, in first example, you are presented with a password prompt to authenticate and to so the system knows that you allowed to install and to use this application. On the second picture, there's more. There are privileges that the application will be using, and that's the main difference. Let's go further. So Ubuntu, in this case, is using what I call classic security approach. I mean, installed and run application acts on behalf of the user, on behalf of us, to the full extent. The application, once run, can do whatever we would do, whatever we could do, while sitting at the terminal with our keyboard, with our mouse, and so on. On the Android, for example, there's something different. The application, of course, also acts on our behalf, but not to the full extent. It was limited to the very specific actions it can do. So, what's about this operating system run on desktop and servers maybe, and to compare them to the mobile or embedded devices, IoT devices, for example. So, the operating system isn't just a piece of software that consumes space on our disks and hogs our CPUs. It governs some helpful services, some precious resources, and it helps us in using it. Of course, there are many resources and services like this one presented here, for example, email, camera, networking. There's not even a point in distinguishing them to services and resources. They may provide some services and have some resources at the same time. It doesn't matter. They live in our operating system and serve us in some way. But the real point here is that with these services and resources, we or our applications can do some specific things, can do some specific actions. Like, for example, in email, you can read, write emails, you can preview your contacts, you can use camera for taking photos, or maybe this very same application also allows you to browse already taken photos, and so on. What's the real point here is that with these services and resources, there are some actions connected, and these actions are further connected with privileges. I mean, if application is going to use, for example, email service, you should be able to tell that it may read and write emails, but maybe couldn't preview all of your contacts and so on. But of course, these services, these resources, are not only for you. I mean, who's going to use Telnet to read emails or write emails? You need some applications in your operating system, and they are really helpful. Email clients, browsers, games, whatever. And in the classic approach to security, like in presented Ubuntu, but it doesn't it isn't limited to Ubuntu. It's rather a class of systems like desktops or servers. All these applications, once installed, have all your privileges. They can act on your behalf. So all of these applications you install have the same rights like you to camera, internet, location services, contacts, and so on. It's not the point to disallow the applications to do so, but there's a point in limiting this access, because it's probably a good thing. So maps have access to location services, maybe even camera could have this access to geotags, the taken photos, but probably calculator or games shouldn't have access to camera or contacts. So what we need is access control to these services and resources. And what do we need to do so? Well, we need to separate things inside the operating systems. First, we need to separate users to tell them apart. This one user can access location services, the other one doesn't. And we need to distinguish, to tell apart the applications. Like maps have access to location services, but games do not. And the first constraint, I mean, separation of users, is already there in Unix systems, Linux systems. And the separation of applications is whole larger and more complicated complex. And the rest of the presentation today is about this mainly. But the solution to this problem of separating users and applications is already there. It's implemented. I'm one of the developers who implemented it, and I'm going to present it to you. All of stuff I'm going to present today is open source, so every one of you can take this, try this, and implement this in your setups. It doesn't have...
Excuse me, can you speak a little bit louder? It's not here.
Oh, sorry. I will try. Okay. So every one of you can take this and apply to new systems, existing systems, and it's, as you will hopefully see in the demo I'm going to present, it's not only limited to embedded devices, but we can go beyond this, but that will come. So the security model I'm presenting was originally initially developed for Tizen operating system. It's a plain Linux distribution. It's meant mainly for embedded and mobile devices. It's open source. It's already shipped on many devices like smartwatches, smartphones, smart TVs. But there are more of them. I mean, more of projects which are using some parts of this security models. Maybe you heard something sometimes on these projects. There are more, and these are just examples of usage. So this new security model consists of three pillars: discretionary access control, Linux security models, in this case SMAC, and a new one, user space based Cynara. I'm going to go through all of them. First is Doug. You probably heard about this. Even if you don't heard of this, you are really using it every day. It's just plain old security model for present in Unix like for 40 years. You know the commands like change owner, change mode, and so on, and this is it. It's used to separate users and their resources. You probably all know how to allow access to your files on Linux systems to some group or users, and this is it. You can have access type of reading, writing, executing, and so on. There's really nothing much to say. It allows to fulfill the first restriction of separating user. And this is first pillar, and it is used for this. The second is SMUG. Who has ever heard of SMUG? Okay, some of you. Maybe SE Linux sounds more bells. Yeah, it's something like this. It's SMUG is one of the Linux security models. It allows to restrict access to the resources, but in different ways than Duck does. In operating systems, you have some entities like processes or files maybe, and you can, thanks to SMUG, label them. For example, you have a file on the file system and you can give it a label in the example label 2, and it's file on our disk. And there's a process, for example, which is labeled with label 1. And we can have some rules which tell what actions the subject, for example, process, labeled somehow, can do on object labeled maybe differently. If they have the same label, then the access is unrestricted. But if the labels are different, there are rules which tell the subject with this label can read but not write the object labeled differently. And of course, many objects and many subjects may have this very same label. So, for example, all files in one of the directories can be labeled with the same label. So the process with distinct rules can access all of them. And maybe other process without rules to access these files will not have this. There are some conventions of labeling objects and subjects in operating system. I mean, it depends on you, but the security model I'm presenting uses this convention. For example, there's label floor underscore really to label some read-only system directories. There is label user to label files in directories of users, and so on. But it is just a convention for simplicity and for ease of administration. There's the third pillar. First two pillars were, well, they were in Linux for a long time. Duck was in Linux for its very beginning, and even longer in Unixes. Smug, I believe, was in Linux from 2008, and other Linux security models were there since the beginning of the century. But Cynara is something new. First of all, it's not in kernel space like the former two were. It's user space one, and it's dedicated for the presented solution. How it works, I will explain in a moment. And this is it. For example, in DAC, you have access rights for the files if some user or some group could read or write this file. In SMAC, you had labels. This label, subject with this label, can read or write object with another label. Here, it's different. For example, we have a service, say it's location service like GPS, and we have some application in operating system like maps. Maps connect to the location service and request the current location of the system, of user of this system. But how does this service know if this particular application can access location? Well, it doesn't. It could have some mapping, some database with the answer for this question. Yes, maps can have location, calculator cannot. But it may work, but it will probably be static, just a static mapping or database. And the second thing is that each service in the operating system would need similar mapping or database. It's not a good solution. What I propose is Cynara. It's that kind of database I was just talking about. It knows all the answers for this kind of questions. Is maps allowed to use location services? Is Facebook allowed to use contact lists? And so on. Cynara is a database, really, but sophisticated one. It can store entries statically, Facebook has access to contact list, but it may also compute these answers on the runtime with some extensions. For example, if you are familiar with iOS or newer Android systems, you could be presented with a pop-up asking if these applications at this time can have access to some service or some resource. And end-to-end, Cynara computes the answer and returns it to the service. And this answer is distinct, yes or not. So it knows if this particular request can be served or not. How does Cynara know all these answers? There are some same defaults built in the system. There are manifests of installed applications. If you're familiar with developing for Android operating systems, then you know what is manifest. It simply tells the operating system which privileges are going to be needed by these applications, and user can accept them or not. There's privacy manager. If you're familiar with newer Android systems, then you know that in the runtime, after the application is installed, you can grant or deny some of the privileges. And this is it. Once you may accept Facebook to use your contact list, but the other day, it doesn't have to be so. And at the end, there's also administrator role who can alter all these choices. So how does it work in practice? I mean, in the life cycle of application, what actions are done? But first, there's another component of this solution. It's called Security Manager, who is a main hub for all this information. It's also a dedicated program. It is used in many different aspects, in many different steps of life cycle of the applications. For example, it takes part in installing and launching applications. It manages different policies and rules in the systems. It's a hub where administrator or users can do their work to manage the rules in the operating system. So, first step in the life cycle of the application is, of course, installation of it, of this particular application. There are files unpacked, but it's really nothing interesting. The more interesting thing is after putting the files on the file system, we grant access with DAC. For example, we apply access rules who can read the files. Next, we label them with SMAC labels, which means we tell what processes can access files, what processes can access other processes, and so on. Next, the application is run. The main step in this launching process is applying so-called security context. Application in this security model has to have this security context, which is which contains not only SMAC label, the process of the application runs with. So we can use these SMAC rules to allow accesses between processes or processes and files, for example, but also groups it runs with. It's also important because we can have accesses to files and so on this particular device. So, how does it work in practice? As I told you before, on the simple example, there is this GPS service. It probably just had request from some kind of application, for example, in this example, maps, to read the location. And as I told you before, it needs to ask Cynara if this access is granted. So what's there? What really happens? First of all, as I told you, in this mission of separation, we are able to distinguish users and processes. So the GPS service in this particular example can tell what user is running this maps application and what this maps application really is. I mean, how is it different from calculator application? So it has UID of the user running these maps, and it has smug label of this maps application. It's worth nothing that all application of this same kind, I mean, from this same executable, are run with the same smug label. Even if they run with different UIDs, for example, Susan and Bob, Susan's maps has label, for example, maps, and Bob's maps application, if it's the same application, runs with the very same smug label. The GPS service knows this credential, these credentials, UID of the user requesting, and the smug label of the application. And it forwards it to Cynara with the request, with the question, if this tuple, this pair of so-called client, in this case, it's label of the application, and this particular user can have access to privilege. In this example, it's location privilege. Cynara is calculating the answer. It may come directly from that database. It may be computed by external plugins like pop-up, like maybe contacting some external service, even maybe Windows domain, whatever. And GPS service gets the answer right back, and it's distinct. It knows it's yes or not, grant access or deny access. And hopefully we can show this on a demo. I prepared the demo on, I don't remember, it's Ubuntu or Fedora. It's not embedded system, definitely, but I just wanted to show you that you are not limited to the embedded or mobile devices. So here we are with two applications installed on the operating system. One is Contacts, and one is some other application, Evil Calculator. What to notice on this first screen is that, as I told you at the very beginning, there are these privileges, like in Android or like in iOS, for example. And here we have this information that Contacts application have read access to contacts denied, and also well, editing contacts is also denied. And we go a little further. Is it working? Yeah. We run this Contacts application, and as you can see, Contacts could not be fetched from Contacts book, which is a service in this example. It could be plain file, like database, but whatever. We know that the access to reading or editing is denied, so this application could not have this access. Next, we change the permissions in real time, I mean, when in live system. And this time, we can access the contacts. Now we try to edit contacts. As you can see, the access for editing is denied. So when we try to save, we have permission denied for this action. Deleting is editing as well, so we cannot. Now we change permission to ask user. So every time some application will try to edit contacts, we will be presented with a pop-up. Now we save this particular edit and we are presented with a prompt to allow this or not. If we deny, then we again have this permission denied, and if we allow, it's done. We could save this contact. What's more, this application was legitimate. I mean, we installed it. It requested in the manifest that it will be using contacts in this particular way. I mean, it requested that it will read contacts and edit contacts, and we have possibility to change these permissions, to alter these permissions, even in live. But there's also another application. It's not so legitimate, but somehow it is present in our operating system. Maybe it's just a random application we download with from internet, and it didn't request any privileges. But let's see what will happen. Okay, so we downloaded this application. It seems to be legitimate. It does what it does. It's a calculator, but it has a hidden function. That's why it's evil. It tries to read our contacts. It wasn't supposed to do so, but with plain old classic security approach, there is nothing to stop this application from accessing the resources from our file system or access services on our operating system. When we use this security model I'm presenting, we can know that this application, which is evil, wants to do something that it's not supposed to do. And we, of course, deny this action. But what if we allowed? Yes, it just read our contacts. And I believe this is it for the demo. Hopefully you now get the idea. Just another implementation detail. This contact service was a service. In this example, it served on DBus IPC, but it doesn't have to be DBus. It could be Unix socket, it could be whatever. But it was IPC, DBus in this particular example. Sometimes we have some resources that we don't want to be governed by a service. For example, we want to have raw access to the camera device on our system, just because it is faster. We can do so as well within this security model. And this is how we use groups. We apply a group, for example, camera users, to the device that is device of our camera, of our microphone, or whatever. And when the application, in this example camera, is launched, we apply this group for this application. We do not apply this group like in classic approach to the user, because if user Bob or Susan was in camera users group, all of their application would have access to this device. But we don't want to. We want to distinguish that camera application has this access and calculator doesn't. So we do not put user in the group, but we put distinct applications of this user. It's done in lunchtime, and it works just like I explained. Okay, that would be it. There are some bonuses. First of all, you probably noticed that when you have some service, like in the examples here, contact service or GPS service, it has to have some code to contact Cynara, to request Cynara, in order to know which requests should be served or not. This is true. The services need some modifications, but they doesn't have to. They don't have to. If the services are using DBus, then it's already done. I mean, we have a patch for DBus, so we can intercept messages on this bus, and it's transparent for both service and client. They don't even have to know of existence of this security model, of Cynara, and so on. You just write config files that some particular service, their methods on DBus are protected with some kind of access right, and that's it. The second bonus is Nether. It allows us to configure the very same access control for networking. I mean, that this application can access network resources, the other doesn't. You can configure it on different access for different hosts, for different protocols, and so on. And the third bonus is nice lot. There are, you can audit all this stuff. I mean, you can follow the requests, you can follow the accesses, you can follow the answers for this, for requests in terms of was this request allowed or denied, and so on. And it, this is important, especially on beginning of work with this security model, because you have many services and applications, and sometimes it's hard to configure it properly from the very beginning. And this tool is helping you with it. Okay, so hopefully I showed you the difference, the main difference between a classic approach to this, to security, and the one I'm proposing. Hopefully, I showed you that this classic mechanism is not enough in modern world with more and more applications from different sources, like different kind of application stores and so on. And that's it. If you have any questions, I think we have some time. Yeah?
Okay. At this stage of development, could your software also fake an access for the application?
Could you explain more? What do you mean by faking?
If you have an application that is evil, but the user wants this application. For example, you have Facebook, and if you install Facebook, they capture all your contacts at the installation process, and afterwards you can block them from your contacts, but at the installation it is mandatory, you gave them access to your contacts, so they are gone. And I have to, the user wants Facebook to run on his device, and if it's not run properly, he will rip off your extension, your security extension, to get this application. Do you understand what I mean?
You mean that if at installation time I grant the application rights to read my contacts?
No. For security reasons, you have to do a fake in direction of that application. You have to fake that your contacts are empty or there are only bullshit in it, and gave them to Facebook, so they capture nonsense. Mm-hmm. And but you can install that application, and afterwards you can block the contents, as the contact contents for the application, and Facebook is fine with this.
Okay, now I get it. First, you don't have to do. I mean, this approach was taken several years ago by Cyanogen mod project, and before Android has this newer security model which allowed in runtime to alter the privileges. But you don't have to do this way, because when you install application and the privilege is privacy oriented, like contacts, like location and so on, it's configured by default to ask user on the first usage, like in newer versions of Android. So, of course, the application, Facebook in your example, in manifests requests access to contacts, but it won't get it before first prompting user if they want to.
Yeah, I understand, but the user wants that application, and if he has to decide will they get my contacts or not, and you make a pop-up, and he can install with a granted, and he cannot install if he says no, so he will say yes and live with that.
Okay, but first of all, the application will be installed anyways. So, I mean, you accept the requested privileges, but they won't be granted before first usage, really. When this Facebook application runs for the first time, and it only then it accesses the contacts. At this time, you can decide, do I accept it or not? But returning nonsense contacts is on different layer. It would need to be implemented in this contact service, for example. This framework that doesn't...
But you said you have to update or implement that in your services. So why doesn't we implement that too?
Yeah, we could implement it this way, but it's we don't think it's really needed. I mean, this pop-up is only one of the extensions to this security model. I mean, there is a plugin which shows pop-up, allow or deny, but you could implement your own extension which presents pop-up, allow, deny, return nonsense. It would be up to you what happens when user chooses the third option. But this framework is very generic. We run it on Tizen smartphones, for example, smart TVs with Tizen. I just showed you on it on Fedora. If we wanted to implement, I mean, we don't know what services exist on a system. It's generic. It just grants accesses or not. It doesn't know about what services are on the system. What do these services do? So implementing such things like return nonsense as contacts is beyond this project's
Has it been run on Ubuntu Touch, for example, yet?
No, I run it on plain Ubuntu, like the desktop, and it works okay. I think that there are no restrictions on running it on Ubuntu Touch. You just have to implement, for example, this pop-up extension for it. I mean, this was just a quick example I hacked in one evening, just to show you on demo. It was in Qt. If you implemented it in toolkit used on Ubuntu Touch, it would work.
Great, thank you. Okay.
How does it technically work? So if a program wants to open an address book which is in some kind of file, does it somehow intercept system calls, or how does it prevent a program from bypassing the...
Okay. If address book was a file on the file system, we would apply a group to this file, for example, contacts users, and only users in this group would have access for this file. And also, only applications which are in this group would have access to these files. So in the launch time of the application here, you have applying groups for the process. So if this database with contacts has group contacts users, then this run application, this launch application, would need to have would have to be in this group to access this file.
And does it not? What happens with network connections?
With what?
When you want to open a network socket, this usually doesn't depend on any kind of groups in Linux.
Yeah, this is done by the special module. It's nether. It's intercepting packets. I don't remember how this technique is called, but it's just like IP tables, which decide which packets can go through and which cannot. It's more like some kind of simple firewall, but it not only checks origin and destination of the packets, but also it knows about which user and which applications created this packet, or which user and which application is going to get this packet.
Thanks.
Okay, thank you.
As far as I'm concerned, you just said that you just hacked up the demo, the privacy manager. I think it's actually a pretty nice solution to have something like that on a desktop system as well.
Thank you.
So are you at any stage planning to do to actually release and work on a privacy manager like that in the future, or was it just for the demo and someone else is going to have to do that?
Okay. First of all, I'm not going to continue on this because it would really need to. It's gonna need much work from the not only administrator of the particular installation, but from managers of distributions. I mean, the contact service presented here run on DBus. So if services run on DBus, we can just patch DBus in one instantiation, in one distribution, and we're okay. But many services don't work on DBus. They open their own sockets, they shared their memory, they shared their files. They would need to be modified in some way. Of course, Cynara provides some helper libraries. So you can use these libraries to modify the services without much effort. I mean, you just link with this library and you have a socket from the client. You just give this library the socket and it makes the work. So it's not much effort to modify services, but there's a lot of them. And for this security model to be effective, you have to modify all the resources or the services. I showed it on a desktop system just to show you it's possible. But if it's feasible, I don't think so.
Yeah, so it's better suited for mobile devices
as it's
intended.
Right.
Because there's one manufacturer who decides what kinds of applications are shipped with by default. And then, of course, they can modify those few applications.
Yeah.
And then the whole system itself is, of course, built around this security model.
Yes, of course. As I told in the beginning, this security model was meant for Tizen operating system. And I worked on this effort. I worked on Tizen, and we could decide which way to go, and we could even implement the needed modifications to the services. And there was limited number of these services. If you want to go to the wild and do it in Fedora or Ubuntu, it's just too much work.
Okay, thanks.
Hello. I have a question regarding the camera example which you have there.
Which one?
The one with the camera users, right? This one.
Yeah.
I wanted to ask you that you activate some group, right, to access the camera.
Yeah.
But what if you want to access the camera and also the GPS? So you activate another group, or like if you have a process in Linux, it's running under one group, so you cannot have process running under two groups.
When the process is launched,
mm-hmm.
it can run with arbitrary number of groups. So you can apply it camera groups, camera users groups, GPS users group, and so on and so forth. It's arbitrary number. Just like user can be at the same time in different groups, the process as well. It can be in several groups in the, at the same moment.
Okay. Okay. Thank you.
Can we, one last question, okay?
Okay, thank you. As far as I understood, Cynara requires a patch debus to operate in a secure manner.
I mean,
is this, are these patches going to be integrated in, into debus?
Not really. I mean, Tizen is open source, and you can download these patches from Tizen.org, but we haven't done an effort yet to upstream these patches to Dbus. But I mean, we take newer and newer versions of Dbus and we backport these patches, but it's not really upstream, and I don't think it will be in some near future. This concept is not so popular. I mean, this is run in several systems like Tizen, for example. Some parts of this model are run in different IoT-oriented distributions, but it's not so popular that it would be accepted in upstream Dbus, I think. Not in near future.
Okay, how does it differ from something like PolicyKit?
It doesn't differ much, but we, to be honest, we tried to use PolicyKit instead of Cynara, but PolicyKit is something that is meant to run in GUI interfaces mainly. So even I don't want to say it was PolicyKit was slow, but it was. If you want, every single request for some services or resource in operating system to be, let's use this word, intercepted, interpreted, and managed, it can't be slow. And PolicyKit was too slow for us. So we implemented, I mean, PolicyKit was okay, but I mean, 100 milliseconds is not much if you show pop-up every time. But if you do several hundreds of requests per second, it matters.
Okay. And one last question for the concept illustrated in the slide. I assume this works something like sudo to supply the additional groups to the process at the startup of the process.
I mean, this launcher is a privileged process which can apply different security contexts, for example, groups.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Okay, we're really out of time, so thank you again for listening.